Hi there, my name's Andy Young and I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland, and welcome to my Andy Mechanic YouTube channel. Now, I've just been for a trip down to Auckland and I've picked up, believe it or not, two new brushes. Now, massive expense of $5.75 New Zealand, and what I need to do is install those two new brushes into this brush pack. I was hoping they'd be able to supply me a complete new brush pack, but they weren't. But hey, $5, nice and cheap, just a bit of extra work. So we'll come to fitting those brushes a bit later on. Before I do that, I do want to check the rest of the alternator. And one of the viewers from the previous video mentioned that those slip rings, because they've worn unevenly and the brush was making contact to part, say one half of the slip ring, but not the other side of the slip ring, hence the bulb was flashing when we rotated the rotor slowly. It could be down to excessive runout on the rotor shaft. That's the shaft that spins to the middle of the alternator. So I'm going to strip the alternator completely, and I'm going to check the runout with a DTI on that shaft, well, actually on the slip rings themselves, and see if there's much of a deviation. I don't think it's going to matter too much with the new brushes, but obviously as the brushes got right to the end of their limit, the brush would make contact in some points and then let no contact in others, hence the bulb flashing. So I'll show you how to strip down the rest of the alternator, and I'm going to do all the tests. I'm going to check the stator windings, I'm going to check the rotor winding as well, and then we'll start to reassemble it. Here we go. Right, so pull it off, one nut. Oh, that was lucky. Sometimes you've got to pull these off with a puller. Right, one pulley and a fan and a spacer, all pretty standard stuff. Right, let's get all that out of the way. Now, with that pulley off the front, the next thing to do is to separate the bridge rectifier, the diode pack here, from the stator. Now, this is a three winding stator. And you'll see there, look, well, maybe not see, do a close-up. Okay, so these are the three wires that come off the stator. Some stators have four wires, some have three. Don't panic, but what we need to do is remove each of these three, one at a time, with a soldering iron. Now, it does look like the wire, the end of the wire, is also crimped into that terminal off the diode pack, so it may prove not a case of not just warming the solder up, we might have to pry that crimp open slightly as well. We'll see how we get on. Let's put a bit of solder on there just to help with the heat transfer into the joint. Oh, there we go, look, and I can pull it out. Almost. There we go. Right, two more to go. Now, I don't portray myself as being the world's greatest solderer. I'm sure you've guessed that already. But like most mechanics, we sort of make it work. See, a little blowtorch would be fantastic for this, but it would destroy the diode pack, so that's not an option. Be about there. There we go. Excellent. That's number two. Right, one more to go. I think really a larger soldering iron will be better for this job, but this is all I've got at the moment. My big one's died. Oh, plus it's got an English plug on it as well. So just by adding a bit of solder, yeah, look at that. Just by adding that bit of solder, just speeds the whole thing up a little bit. Cool, done. Right, that should come away from there now. Brilliant. Okay, so that's the diode pack now removed, and obviously we're going to be testing that a bit later on. I'll show you how to do that and I'll give you some Nissan specs for that too. Okay, next job, we should be able to withdraw that shaft. Now, sometimes they'll just pull straight out. Here we are, look. Make sure those stator wires are out of the way. Obviously very careful not to snap them off because that would be tragic. There we go. Cool. And there's an internal spacer as well, which fits on there. Great. Okay, well, this alternator is pretty much stripped down now. It's as far as we need to go. And you can see that that is the stator. We've got the three windings, and we can do some tests on that very shortly. But first, let's see if this shaft is bent. Okay, so I've got the rotor set up in the V-blocks. They're a bit wonky. One's different to the other, unfortunately, but it's in the V-blocks, makes no difference. And DTI is set up as far really inboard on the shaft as I can get, which will obviously highlight any kind of deviation. Now what we need to do is obviously zero, well first of all just lift the gauge up and push it down and make sure you're getting a reading both ways so the gauge isn't bottomed out, the little finger's not bottomed out, and then set that to zero. It's pretty delicate, there we go. Now what we're going to do is rotate the shaft and there we go, and see how much it deviates. Alright, so as we rotate the shaft, you'll see that it goes from zero, which is just about there, to 0.02. There we go. Oh, that was my thumb. Okay, so we've got, I would say, just under 0.02. A reading there, that's in millimeters by the way. So let's check the specs and see what we're allowed. So it turns out we've got 0.02 of run out on that shaft. Now I've just checked the old Nissan workshop manual, and believe it or not, thanks Nissan, there is absolutely no spec whatsoever available for that particular check, not for this alternator. So I'm going to give it a thumbs up, doesn't seem too bad. But let's just check now the run out or the deviation on each of the two slip rings and see if that's much different. Now sure, it's a different distance away from the V-block, it's going to vary a little bit, but it should give us an idea. I don't think this is a major problem because I think once the new brushes are in, the spring inside the brush will allow for that tiny, tiny variation as the slip ring is rotating. Whereas on the old brushes, because they're at full extension, then there was no additional distance that the spring could give to take up that tiny gap, and that's why of course it broke circuit. So let's check the slip rings now and then we can move on. Okay, so this is the outer slip ring. And we've got a bit on that one. Nice. Okay, so about 0.04 of a mil on that one, but that one was staying in contact with the brush all the way around, but I think that brush was very slightly longer. This is the suspect slip ring. Let's check that next. Okay. That was a bit of a sudden flick, wasn't it? Okay. Well, that's about up to 0.05, isn't it? Okay, well again, Nissan don't give us any particular specifications for this other than the overall diameter, so let's measure that. Okay, so Nissan say that the minimum diameter for these is 33.6 millimeters. Let's see what we get. Okay, so that the inner one is 34.71, so there's plenty of material left on there, and the outer 34.64. Perfect. So all I think we need to do now is just give those a very quick clean up, get rid of that rough scoring so the new brushes bed in nicely. Now there's two more checks we can do before we take the rotor out of the vise. First of all, we can check the integrity of the single winding that's inside there. That's what creates the magnetic field that cuts through the stator. So one end of it, well, each end of that is on each of these two slip rings. So if we touch the probes onto there, we should get continuity. Well, that's good news. Okay, so that's all good. Now, what we shouldn't get is continuity between either of those slip rings and ground, ground being the shaft. So we'll keep one on there. That's good. And that's good. Cool. Okay, that rotor is a pass. Right, we'll just give it a quick clean up on the lathe on these two slip rings. And then we can move on to the next bit. Few grooves in there, look at that. Well, luckily we've got plenty of material left on these slip rings, so it doesn't matter too much if we take a bit more off. We can go down to 33.6, so should be fine. Let's have a look at that. Okay. Well, I reckon that's good enough. I don't want to go mad. Cool, done. Okay, well, we're cooking on gas. That's the rotor all sorted out. The slip rings nicely cleaned up. Sure, there's a couple of little grooves still left in there, but I don't want to sacrifice all that metal off those slip rings just to make them super smooth. They'll do for now. Who knows, this alternator might get reconditioned again in 26 years' time. Cool. Okay. Oh, Ben's off to go and cut the grass. Now the next job is to check the stator. And to do that, you're going to need some kind of multimeter again that's got a continuity check. Now, Nissan don't give us any particular resistance readings that we should get for these windings. All they tell us is, if you get continuity, it's good between the windings. And if you don't get continuity, it's bad. And we're also going to do an earth check to make sure that none of these windings are going down to ground, so you should get no continuity between any of these three windings or any of these three wires and the casing of the alternator. That would be bad, obviously. Right, let's get it checked. Okay, so meter on continuity, and let's have a little beep. Makes it easier for everybody, doesn't it? Right, stick that down there. So if you can hear a beep, we've got continuity, and if you can't hear a beep, we haven't. Right, very simply, we're going to go between each of these three. Cool. 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 Right. It all looks pretty good to me. Very happy with that. Okay, so that's a pass. Now, we need to go from each one down to ground onto the casing. And that just checks the insulation between those windings and ground. Cool. Okay. So as far as Nissan's concerned, that's also a pass. And just before you sign it off, I suppose, have a quick look around. Make sure there's no poling. Make sure that the rotor's not been catching on the inside of the stator. Check the bearing. Bearing's good. Cool. Right. That's also a pass. Now we've got a diode pack to check. Okay. One diode pack. Now, inside here, we've got diodes, obviously, and there's one here, another one here, and there's quite a few of them. Now, we've got two plates that make up the diode pack. We've got a positive plate, so I'll mark that up. And we've got a negative diode plate, and that'll become apparent very shortly. Okay, so first job is to get your multimeter and set it onto the diode test, which is that little symbol there, look. You're not going to get a beep this time. And then get your two probes. Now, like I said earlier on, we've got a positive diode plate and a negative. The negative is a small one, and the positive is the large one. And the first test involves us putting the positive probe onto the positive plate, and then go around with the negative and just touch each of the diode terminals. Now we should not get continuity. Now just to check the meter, we'll go probe to probe. There you go, look, we've got continuity. So we'll go onto each of these terminals and it should stay open circuit. And that will validate that test. Excellent. Okay, that's a pass. They're all open circuit. Perfect. No current flow. So now we swap the probes around, put the negative probe onto the positive plate, and do exactly the same test again. And this time we should get continuity. If you look at the screen for some numbers. There we go, 0.445. There we go, same again, and the same again. Great. Okay, that's two tests out of four done, and that's so far we've got a pass. Okay, so the third test, we're going to be using the negative diode plate this time, and we're going to put the positive probe onto the negative diode plate. So I'll just hold that there on my finger, and then again we're going to go across each of the diode terminals, and we should get continuity. There we go, and we did. So we can get a better connection. I think it's my... there we go, 0.449. And it is really important that you get a proper connection on these. I think it's my... there we go, look, okay. Yeah, it's this probe here, look, it's not quite making contact. Let's just try that. Try again. There we are, look, 0.439, 0.445, 0.445. Cool. Now what we do is swap the probes. So a negative probe onto the negative plate. Make sure we're not bridging the two plates together. There we are, look, hold that together. Bit of pressure on there. And again, the three terminals. This time it should be open circuit. Cool, which it is. Right. Now, we've done four tests. There's still one more test to do. If you look down here, we've got what Nissan call some sub-diodes, and they're in here. There's one there, one in there, and one in there. And what we need to do now is make sure that there's no continuity between those two terminals. So we've got three more diodes to check. Okay, that's easy enough. Right, so onto there. And onto there, cool, and that's open circuit, good. And onto that one, and onto there, cool, open circuit. And lastly, this one here, cool, open circuit, brilliant. Looks like the old bridge rectifier is still good to go. That's a pass. Okay, so we're cooking on gas this afternoon. The rotor's good, we've checked all that. The stator's good, we've checked that for continuity and ground insulation and so on, it's all good. And we've just tested the bridge rectifier. We've just tested all the diodes in there, and we tested basically nine diodes, didn't we? And they're all good. Nine diodes? I don't know, enough. So the last thing to do now, because I can't test the regulator unit, because I don't have my transfer tester here, it's at work unfortunately, but we can fit those brushes and then we're going to put the whole thing back together again, and hopefully, fingers crossed, my $5.75 worth of parts will have fixed this alternator and get it put back on the truck and it can start charging up all the time. It did charge today for about 10 minutes, which is rather lucky, but I'd much rather it charge all the time, because you know, when you use the lights and stuff. Haven't been able to go to the pub on an evening until I get this fixed. It's a good incentive, isn't it? Right, here we go. Let's get this sorted out. Okey-dokey, right. So a bit of soldering just to replace these brushes. I'm going to warm that solder up. Come on, solder, you can do it. Maybe we'll just use a bit of new stuff just to help things along a little bit. Once that solder melts, we should be able to withdraw the old brush. That's the plan. There we go. Old brush and spring. Perfect. Now for number two. I think threading the new one through could be fun, couldn't it? Cool. Brush and the spring. Right. Time just to clean off all this old solder. And then we should be able to thread it through. Because we can't at the moment, can we? Okay. Maybe my little flat screwdriver is going to help. I don't have one of those little solder sucky up things, so it's not the greatest idea. Normally I can never get the solder on. Okay, maybe we have a little hole to drill. Maybe it's too big. Yeah, next side down, I think. Cool. Okay, so don't forget to thread the old spring through onto the new brush on the wire. And then you have the joyous fun of trying to thread it through that tiny hole. There it goes. Oh, look at that. Professional. Now, Nissan stipulate that the brush, when you solder it on, should be protruding between 10.5 and 11.5 mil. Now you can see on the casing, I've put this little line here, that's for the shape of the brush, because you could put it in the wrong way around. You could fit it like that as well, which of course will cause a problem later on. So I'll just turn that right around. There we go. And just to hold it in place, I've been having a little think about this. And I think probably the easiest way to do it while I'm just soldering it up is to use a pair of mole grips off there. Let's just set the length first. So 10.5 to 11.5 millimeters. Okay. Well, that's bang on. That is 11.5. So we'll just hold it there. We'll fit that on there like that. Is that going to hold it? Yeah, that'll work. Okay, we'll just spin it round so we're soldering from the top. Okay, soldering time. Shouldn't be too bad to do. Perfect. Right, that works for me. And then we can just snip off the excess. Cool. Job done. Right, number two. Okay, let's give that a bit of a go. Oh, this guy's getting good. Okay, so again, that way around. Cool. Now I reckon we can just make it the same length as the other one. And we'll just use the old mole grips to hold it in place. So, about there. Cool. Okay. Just double check for about right. There we go, 11 and a half. Right, see if we get some solder on there. Well, it sounds like Ben's finished the first lawn. What was that, Ben? What was that bang?
It backfired.
Cool.
We do sometimes when you're doing off.
Brilliant. Okay, cut off the excess. Job done. Okay, so there you go. New brushes. Woohoo! Fitted. Wherever they are. They're fantastic. And you can see my little telltale mark. Paid off because I got them right around. I've got to watch myself because if I can get it wrong, I often get it wrong. Anyway, so that's now the new brushes installed into the brush pack. And well, I think we're about ready for a rebuild. Not bad soldering actually, Mr. Young. After a while, we got there in the end, didn't we? Okay, yeah, let's put that alternator back together. Fingers crossed, it's going to work. Hokey-dokey, right. Not entirely sure whether we'll get away with this or not. I might have to clean off all the old solder first, but give it a go. Okay. Oh, it's looking pretty good. Okay, I think we'll get them all into place. And then we'll go around and then we'll just go around and solder them all. Just finish off soldering them up. Okay, that's that one. Now it gets a bit more tricky. Almost. A bit more. Right, one more to go. Now this one might need some pliers for. There's Ben when you need him. Oh, look at that. There we go. Okay, sort of half in. There we go. Cool. That's pretty good, actually. Okay, we'll just ease that back into place. There we go, and I think it's pretty good for solder. We'll just run a little bit more across the top. Hopefully nothing will spring out. Yeah, that's one. Two. Thank you. There we go. Let's get the excess off the bottom. Brilliant. Okay, so the reassembly is a little bit different to the disassembly. And the reason for that is we need to separate the stator from the front casing. And the front casing is the last one to go on. So we're sort of starting from the back and building it up. When we took it apart, I pulled the rear casing off first. It's a lot easier to build it up this way. Right, first job is to fit that little insulator washer that sits on the back of the B-post. There's the B-post there, look. If you forget that, then you're going to have lots of sparks and definitely no charge. So we'll stick that in there. And then we can fit the brush pack with the voltage regulator. So that sits in there like that. And you've got one bolt already in place, so you can line that up. Put that through the hole. Excellent. Okay, now what we also need to do is to pull those brushes back, but if we can actually fit the nut onto there to hold that one in place. And it's an 8mm spanner. We'll do it too tight just yet. There we go. Okay, so don't forget that insulator. That needs to go, it's just dropped out. That needs to go just under there. There we go. Perfect. Okay, now the next job is to pull back those brushes and fit the little pin that goes into there. Now, anything that will fit down, a drill bit's pretty good actually, so I'll find a drill bit. We'll push those brushes all the way in, actually further in than flush, so we can then thread the drill bit through to hold them back, because they're going to need to be held back when we put the shaft in, otherwise you're going to break your brushes off, and that's bad. And that pin will just go down there. I think we'll use a larger one actually. Let's try that. Cool. In the vise, I think. Okay, so if you can see that or not down there, look, that's the drill bit just poking through from that pinhole from the back, and that's holding those brushes back ready for when we install the shaft. And the next bit is to install the stator with the diode pack already on, because we've soldered that on, haven't we? Okay, so you've got the three holes here, and they line up with these three studs. It's a bit of a jiggling act. You'll work it out. What's quite useful is that mark we put on the casing earlier on. Okay. Excellent. Now, we've got two bolts to fit. Now this one that doesn't have the insulator with the round head, that goes through the B plus post. So that goes down there, look. It goes all the way through and sticks out the back. Now don't forget we've got that insulator to fit on the outside as well, so we'll stick that on there. And got the larger 12mm nut, so we'll just wind that down there. Hold that all into place. I think we used a socket for that, didn't we? We'll just do everything finger tight for now, I think. Just in case. Right, that's that one done. And we can also fit the three studs off the diode pack. Just grab a little socket, that'll make it a bit easier, won't it? One, two, three. Again, all just finger tight for now. Excellent. That one. Okay, cool. Right, what's left? Well, we've got one more stud to fit, and that's this one. Now, this one is square end, which matches the other one on the back of the voltage regulator, and that just wants to go down there, look. And it is splined, so it may not drop all the way through first off. We can give it a little tap very carefully with our special screwdriver. There we go. And now we can put the last of those small nuts on there. And again, just finger tight for now. Cool. Okay, so that's the gubbins end, the complicated end, all assembled now, and the brushes retracted, ready for us to fit the rotor shaft. Right, time to stick it in the vise, I think. Okay, so it's not that easy to see, for you guys at least. What we need to do now is just very carefully insert the rotor shaft. Now remember, it's this end in first, obviously, with the slip rings. Trying not to touch the stator if we can help it. There we go. Make sure you push the rotor shaft all the way into position. There we go. So it's all the way down. It's really important you do that right now. Otherwise you'll have problems later on. Okay, so the next job is we can now fit the end plate. Now make sure you've got that that spacer on the end, and we've got the end plate here, look. And it's also important that you line up the marks we've put on the casing. Oh, sorry, camera. There we go. Brilliant stuff. Okay, right. Let's fit some casing bolts. Okay, I'm just gonna put a little bit of copper paste on each of these because, you know, one day I've got to get back in there again. No doubt. Okay. Now it's important when you're doing these casing bolts that you do them up evenly, and it's going to draw all three components together nice and tight. Last one. Great stuff. And now you can just go around and give all these little 8mm bolts, nuts, a little tweak. Don't go mad. Don't want to crack in the insulators. Just hold it with the pliers again, give it a bit of a tweak with the old spannery. There we are. And again, don't go mad because there's an insulator in there that you could crack. I don't want to crack there.
Cool. Happy with that. Right, that's a little 10mm nut to go on there. Okay, so we'll spin it round, we'll put the pulley and the fan back on at the front, then we'll come round to the back and we'll fit the pump. But I want to test it before I fit the pump. Okay, so we've got a spacer first of all, only goes on one way on this particular alternator. And then we'll stick the fan on. Cool. And now Mr. Pulley. And finally, the nut. Okay, all we need now is a good rattle gun. Here we go.
Wow, it's been a long afternoon filming this. It's taken quite some time. There's a lot of shots. Okay. So, Mr. Alternator is all back together with his new brushes. There's only one thing left to do, and that's test it. God, I hope it works. Okay, moment of truth. We've got battery voltage. We've got amperage on the clamp ammeter to the positive to and from the battery. We've got ignition obviously on, so we've got our battery light on the dashboard. It's illuminated and it's wired up exactly the same way as it was wired when we first did the bench test on the alternator. Okay, I'm going to spin it up again with the drill and let's see what happens. This should go out. We should see an increase of voltage to about 14.5 and we should see a reasonable chunk of amperage going into this battery because it's only about, 60-70% charged. So we should see that go to probably about 20 or 30 amps. We should see that go to 14.5 volts and we should see the bulb go out. If none of this works, it tells me that the only component that we didn't test is the voltage regulator and that must be faulty. Hopefully not. Okay, here goes. Whoa, look at that! 13 point, oh, it's climbing. This drill's getting hot. Good stuff. Fixed it! Bloody hell, it works. I am so chuffed. It's back in action again. All I need to do now is refit that the vacuum pump on the back. I can put it back on my truck and not worry about the battery charging up anymore. It's cost me $5.75 New Zealand cents. That's about worth it, I reckon. Excellent job. Thank you very much, AES. You've been a big help to get my truck back on the road again. Okay, well, I'm going to sign it off there. You don't need to refit the pump, the vacuum pump on the back. Well, hopefully one or two of you might have found this video to be helpful because it's taken a damn lot of filming today and a long drive to Auckland, but hey, I needed that anyway. So if you'd like to subscribe to the channel, why not click on the subscribe button and you'll see a little gear icon turn up. Click on the gear icon and then you can turn on notifications if you like. And that way our friends down at YouTube will send you an email as and when I upload any new videos. And there's usually, I don't know, 3 or 4 every single week. A few more this time of year, maybe a few less during December because I'm busy marking. You'll also find me on Facebook, Instagram, Google+, and Twitter. And you can communicate through any of those portals if you wish. But I would prefer your first port of call to be through YouTube because, you know, that's where the videos are and that's where people look for further information and questions and answers. So do that for us and that'd be great. Okay, well, that's about it. My name's Andy Young and I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland. And you've been watching my Andy Mechanic YouTube channel. Cheers, crew. Over and out. Okay, just like Ivan does at Pine Hollow Auto Diagnostics, here is some bonus footage. This is the alternator back in the truck and working correctly. So turn the ignition on. There's the battery light. Big thumbs up. Woohoo! Now we start the machine up and the battery light goes out just like it did on the bench. Fantastic. Let's go and take a look at the voltage. Now I've got the engine on fast idle and we're currently producing 14.2 There you go. So it's all going pretty well. Give it an even faster idle. Excellent.